This morning, I want to speak to you on revive us again. We talk about revival. We talk about we need revival in the land. And I do believe that with all my heart, that we do need a revival. And I believe without a shadow of a doubt, we need a revival within our church settings. We need a revival. And if you have your Bibles this morning, I want you to turn with me to Psalms 85. Psalms 85, the psalmist here is making mention to God that he has been good God to them. Matter of fact, he talks about all the captivity of Israel and that how God had brought them out of that captivity and has forgiven their iniquities and their sins, basically. And God is a God who forgives and forgets. He gives you a new start, a new beginning. And that's what I like far more than anything else, that God is able to forgive and forget and give us that new beginning in Him. And a lot of times down here we are seeking forgiveness from one another, but oftentimes we don't receive that forgiveness because we'll hold grudges and we'll hold different things and we'll just keep pondering on it. But God forgives and forgets and put it behind. He never brings that to your remembrance again. And when you ask for forgiveness, He grants that forgiveness. And thank God for that. Amen. Thank God for a God like that, amen, that will give us that forgiveness. So the psalmist is acknowledging all of that. And then he goes on in verse 6 and 7. He says these words, "Will thou not revive us again, that your people may rejoice in you?" See, we can't rejoice in the Lord until we have revived and rekindled that fire that we once had when we first came to know Him as our Lord and Savior. Does anybody in the house remember the first time that you invited Christ to come into your heart and how excited and how joyful you were? And as time progressed, maybe that joy has dwindled down, you know. As the flame has kind of got on a pilot instead of a full flame that you need to have in your life to bring that joy and that fulfillment of that new life that God has given to you. So we want to rekindle that this morning. And he said, "Will you not revive us again, Lord, that thy people may rejoice?" And he goes on in the next verse and he says these words, "Show us thou mercy, O Lord, and grant us thou salvation." Grant us that salvation. It's easy to see that we need a revival in our day, but part of the reason we don't see revival is that we expect it to start in the wrong place. In 2 Chronicles 7:14, a very favorite scripture of mine, as well as a very frequent scripture that you see many, many times. "If my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land." We are God's people, not by our national birth, but by our spiritual birth. Everyone who accepts Christ as their personal Savior becomes a child of God. But so many times we want God to fix others, but first we need Him to fix us. So when God tells us His revival depends on the repentance of His people, it applies to us. And like I said, we expect revival to start in numerous ways. Sometimes we think revival is evangelism, you know, where we get evangelists in for 2 or 3 days or a week, and that's revival. And then we go on and we think the revival is because of emotions. If we got a good service going on and everybody hollers, shouting, and praising the Lord, that's revival. My friend, they are far from revival. Because revival is a renewal of spiritual life in an individual among a group of people where everyone is focused individually on their spiritual journey with Christ. And that's when revival takes place. It's when we get fired up within our hearts and in our souls about what God has done for us. And that's when revival can take place. And revival is rekindling what God has done in you so you can share with others. That's revival. And folks, we're not sharing the way we should be sharing what God has done for us. And how I know that's the case is because our churches are not filled today. We might have a good crowd, but we could have a greater crowd if we had revival taking place within us, that we shared what God was doing through us and in us. If I'm talking too fast, raise your hand. Oh, I want to slow it down, because I want to kindle a revival fire within your heart today, as God has rekindled a fire within my heart. Boy, I'm excited. Because, see, when the church has revival, the church will be alive and well. And what I mean by that, hey, man, you don't have to put a question mark where they go to church. They already know where you go. They know you're a child of God. They'll never have to put a question mark there. I wonder if they are Christian or not. They don't never have to wonder when there's a revival in your heart. Hello? They never have to ask the question. And a church on fire for God will be a church that is a light on the hill. Everybody knows, amen, they're out there. Amen, they're out there witnessing for God. They're out there, amen, in the community. They're out there, amen, being the example of what God is and what He's about. But revival is not an evangelistic meeting or emotional a piece of it, but it's a renewal of spiritual life in an individual among a group of people. When is revival needed? That's a good question, isn't it? When is revival needed? I believe without a shadow of doubt, whenever the love of God's people has grown cold, a revival needs to take place. And boy, we've seen love grown cold. I mean, I have never seen a world in such a turmoil where people do not love one another. Not even family can get along. You got people, you know, they don't have any respect for mom or dad. Don't have any respect for any officials. No respect whatsoever. Matter of fact, we wouldn't have so many school shootings if kids were taught how to respect the adults. Hello? I mean, we see the love of many waxing cold in our day and time. That love is waxing cold because there's not a revival within the church. If the revival was in the church, amen, the church would be on the job. And praise God, we would be seeing getting things done. And we'll see a difference in the world. Another sign is complacency. Self-satisfaction. A satisfaction with the status quo. Oh, I'm good. I'm good. I like things the way they are. Let's don't change. A lack of concern for the lost. Oh, boy, we see that a great deal. We see a lack of concern for the lost. The church is not concerned anymore about reaching lost souls for Jesus Christ. They're concerned about the crowd. They're concerned about the entertainment. But they're not concerned about the souls of men and women and boys and girls. And that goes back to the love waxing cold. Listen, folks, there are many preachers in the pulpit today. They're up there for the paycheck, not there to win the soul. They're there to have a notoriety. Look at me. I am Pastor so-and-so. I am Pastor so-and-so. But they don't walk the walk, and they don't talk the talk. They compromise the Word of God. They say you can live any type of lifestyle you want to. And you can still go to heaven. That's a lie from the pits of hell. The Bible says that you come to God, you ask forgiveness of your sin. He's faithful and just to forgive you of all your sins and cleanse you. And cleanse you from all unrighteousness. Amen. Cleanse you. That means, amen, He forgets you. He gets you out of that old lifestyle, brings you into a new lifestyle, and He washes all of that old lifestyle away that you can walk in the newness of life as in Christ Jesus. That's the true gospel, amen, that will bring true repentance to a heart that will enlighten them to walk in the ways of the Lord. But revival needs to take place when we see the lack of concern for the lost. We see hide and covering of secret sins, animosity toward other Christians, and having that unforgiving spirit. Being filled with pride and a condition of spiritual standing where we are less than we were before. We see all of that taking place. And there are danger signs, friend, that we need to recognize and say, Lord, send revival. Lord, send revival. What kind of revival do we need, though? We need that old-fashioned, heaven-sent, Holy Ghost revival touching me. Touching me first and touching you. We need a soul-saving, devil-chasing, Holy Ghost revival. Devil-chasing. Some of us, you know, we allow the devil to chase us around when we should be chasing him around, huh? Hello? We should be chasing him around instead of him chasing us. We need a revival that will resurrect the dead church. And Lord knows we got some dead churches. But I'm thankful this church ain't dead. They're alive. I've heard them breathing. I've heard them praising the Lord this morning. They're alive. But does the world know that you are alive? Jesus didn't run and hide after his resurrection. He revealed himself to the people. And you and I, as the living church of the Almighty God, need to reveal ourselves to the people that he is still alive. And he's alive and well within us. We need a resurrected church. If your heart isn't on fire for God, run to the Word of God and let it stir it up in you. Listen, a fire needs to be constantly attended to, right? Well, let me take you back to the wintertime, okay? Because some of you forget, a fire needs to be constantly attended to. Or else it's going to go out. You can put oil in a furnace, you'll have a fire, but when the oil is gone, your fire goes out. You can have a wood stove and a wood fire, but if you don't continue to put wood on the fire, it's going to go out, and the only thing you have is embers. Well, preacher, I don't have neither oil nor wood. I have one of them heat pumps. Well, let me tell you, you have to have a constant flow of electricity for that heat pump to give you heat. If you interrupted that, if something interrupted that, you will not have heat. So you have to constantly maintain whatever fire you got. And friend, that is no different with us in our spiritual fire that's in our heart. We have to constantly attend to it. Amen. Praise God. We get down on our knees. Amen. We'll put another log on the fire. Amen. We get in God's Word. We put another log on the fire. We get, amen, in touch with God, and we lift our hands to Him, and we praise Him. We put another log of the fire, glory to God. And when we got that fire blazing, honey, we got to let it go, and we got to share it abroad, and we got to touch the hearts of people. Amen. With the glove of God. Amen. Whoa, I'm fixing to have church here. I'm fixing to break loose here. Glory to God. Amen. Amen. We need a fire that will resurrect the dead church. Revival means a return to life. Whew. Amen. How you know that what it means? Well, Jesus declared to the church of Sardis in the book of Revelation, there is a name that there liveth, but he said they're dead. What does a dead church look like? They're going through the motions. What do you mean? Well, I'll go to church today. I'll make it. Ain't but an hour. Reckon I can tough it out for an hour. I'm mighty tired, though. And they go through the motion. Have you ever seen folks who just go through the motion? The dead church, they just go through the motion. And Lord, they don't know if God is in 40 miles of the place. They're just going through the, well, it's this thing to do. We just go to church. Once a week is good enough for me. And sometimes I won't even make that one. Well, I made it. I would look at my watch, but we got all these, got these phones now. Oh. Amen. Thank God it's over. I'm gone home. I done did my job. That's a dead church. You ain't got no life. You didn't come expecting God to do something in your life or anyone else's life. I hope none of you came like that today. Oh, we're gonna resurrect you, amen. He said that has a saying that you're living, but you're dead. That's Jesus speaking to the church. Jesus speaking to one who's supposed to have life, that's supposed to be vibrant, supposed to, having the light beaming from them. But he said that has a saying that there are livers, but you're dead. You're not doing what I told you to do. You're not faithful. You're not committed. Where are you? Where are you? Uh-oh, let me give you some more before you pass out, all right? Here we go. He said to the church at Laodicea, he said, he calls upon the Laodicean church to repent that they thought they had a need of nothing, but in essence, they were needing a great deal. He rebuked the church at Ephesus for having left their first love. Elements of all the seven churches you find in the book of Revelation is a sign of today's church. What do you mean? Some folks got the church, a name on the church roll, and that's about it. They ain't interested in the church. They ain't interested in the things the church needs to be doing. They just got the name on the roll just to say they're a member of his church. Others are satisfied with the way things are, so they remain the same. They ain't up for no change. And then you got some who are too concerned about their own agenda to see the need. Uh-oh. They don't see the need of themselves, much less someone else. They become so concerned about the material things the world has to offer. That's all they're concerned about. They don't really see the need that they need God more and more each day. They don't see their neighbor needs the Lord's help. And sometimes a helping hand. They don't see where the church itself needs the helping hand. Then we got some who cry out to God, "Will thou revive us again, God?" And God will revive us again. But we have to do something on our behalf for God to revive us again. And what is the important thing that we can do to bring revival? How can we have revival? Remember, God is the only one who can send revival. He alone is a source. Because the psalmist says, "Will thou revive us again?" It is impossible to schedule and plan a revival because it's not on our time schedule. It's on God's. Hello? So what we must do? We pray. The important thing for a revival to take place is that you pray. And what are we to pray for? Well, we're to pray that God will forgive us of our sins. The things that has dampened the fire within us. You ever heard that old saying, somebody done poured water on your wood, hello? And put your fire out. So you got to dry that wood up, and prayer is a great key to doing so. And asking God to forgive, amen, whatever has put your fire out. So that fire can be rekindled within you. And there is more you can do after you pray. But there is nothing you can do until you pray. The lack of power in many of our churches can be traced directly to the members' lack of prayer. And a lack of revival is a lack of people praying to God. We must face up to spiritual realities. We need to see ourselves as we are and be honest. God, my fire is not where it needs to be. Please forgive me of anything that may try to extinguish my fire. We need to acknowledge God for who He is. Who He is, and quit playing games with God. And we must see sin for what it is. Confess it, repent it, and forsake it. And we must desire to be revived. The reason we don't see a revival fire sweeping across our land like the great awakenings of the past is due to the fact we don't want to see it bad enough. Hello? Because if we're sincere about revival taking place, when the altar call is given, it won't be room enough for people to come. Because, see, if we have a heart's desire for revival, we'll be willing and anxious for God to send it. And we will continue to ask and seek God until the revival fire falls. Matter of fact, He told His disciples to go to the upper room, right? After He ascended to heaven, He said, wait till you was endured with power from above. What did they do in the upper room? Did they play cards? Did they roll dice? Did they gamble? No. Did they do the things of the world? No. Read the book of Acts. They prayed until God responded. And are we sincere enough to pray that revival will take place, starting right here at New Beginning? Because this is where we're at. This is where we worship. This is where God sent us today to worship. Are we sincere enough to pray that revival fires will fall and let it start right here, Lord? Will we seek God in prayer for that to happen? Let's don't be like many Christians today, going through the motion, but not really seeing the action. So I'm going to ask you today, would you help me pray that a revival takes place? Starting right here with us today. That God will use us to win the lost, whatever the cost. Because today is the day. And friend, if you're here and you don't know the Lord Jesus Christ, let me start with you today. Amen. And encourage you to come. You won't regret it. It's the best life you can live. And boy, I tell you what, it's a peace that passes all understanding. And if the devil has given you a fit in this life, let me encourage you today to ask the Lord to forgive you and invite Him into your heart and start this day, amen, with a revival fire kindled within you that will burn through eternity. So let me encourage you with that today. And friend, today, if you're here and you know the Lord Jesus Christ, let me encourage you to rekindle that fire today that we see revival take place in our land. Because it needs revival. It needs revival.